First of all, I'd like to thank Benjamin, Indiana, and Nico for the idea and for organizing, for making this meeting possible. I will talk a little bit following on Nico's tracks, not on new materialism exactly, but on theories of post-hegemony, which are related to that. And because I think one way forward, the conference is about discourse theory and ways forward, one way forward is to take into account criticism that have been addressed to discourse theory and see what we can do with them. And usually, especially if you are a student, the criticism that you are interested in are those that come from the mainstream. So I remember once I was participating in a job interview and I had to do a presentation in the department, and I did the presentation, then there were questions, somebody asked me, this is all fine, what is the relationship with the real world? So this is the anxiety, especially if you are a student, if you're Viva, job interview, whatever. But I think there are other criticisms that do not come from mainstream political science or other sciences, but from other strands like new materialism or post-hegemony, and I want to deal particularly with this kind of criticism. And this is a continuation, I think, to a certain extent, like what Nico said, the relationship between old materialism, the Marxist inflection, and new materialism. There is also the old critique, I don't know whether people remember the old fight between Laclau and Geras in New Left Review in the 80s when Hegemon Social Strategy was published. There was a big fight which was centering around immediacy and mediation. I think that, of course, one of the strong points of discourse theory was that there is this discursive mediation of the real. And, of course, there was also a revenge of the real, if you want to put it like that, coming from a Marxist perspective. And Norman Geras was the main representative of that. There were a couple of exchanges in New Left Review, very vitriolic, very harsh, really. But the idea was that, do you neglect the real, do you neglect the material, is this an idealist argument or not? And strangely enough, this is something that has resurfaced in the last few years, the last 10 years, let's say. And I have been doing some work on that during the last few years, and I want to say a few things about that. It has resurfaced in these arguments about post-hegemony and new materialism and so on and so forth. And it all started with the publication of a book by Richard Day. Jason might remember Richard. He came to Essex, I remember, for 6 months or something. And then he published a book. Obviously, he was not very impressed by our work. And then he published a book with a telling title, Gramsci is Dead. So that was published in 2005, I think. It has been translated to many languages. And he has an argument which is quite interesting. It's not a very theoretical argument. It's an empirical, a political argument. He focuses on what he calls the newest social movements. So you have the old social movements, like the labor movement, the new social movement. You have the newest social movements, who are supposedly some autonomous anarchic groups, some station somewhere in a mountain, whatever, I don't know. And these are the newest social movements, and these really, so to speak, escape the logic of hegemony. So this is the end of hegemony. Hegemony cannot really help us analyze these movements, because these movements themselves want to articulate the politics beyond hegemony. And the argument is that if you articulate a kind of hegemonic project, you still accept the rules of the game, so to speak. So it's better to escape completely this game. That is his argument. And it is a political argument, it's not a very theoretical one, although he does seem to be inspired by, I don't know, Spinoza and people like Agamben and Hart and Negri and references like that. The argument becomes even more articulate with the intervention of Scott Lash, who writes a few years after Richard Day, a couple of years after Richard Day in 2007, he publishes a paper in Theory, Culture and Society about post-hegemony. So the actual concept post-hegemony is not coined by Richard Day, it's coined by Scott Lash. And he makes this argument, which is very respectful to a certain extent. He's not really diminishing the importance of hegemony theory, but he says hegemony theory was okay for a certain period, but now we have entered a new era, and we cannot use hegemony in order to analyze this era. So we are in a post-hegemonic terrain completely. So it was okay in the 70s, in the 60s, to use hegemony in cultural studies, in populism, in political theory, and so on and so forth. He's not saying that hegemony was a flawed concept. It was important for that particular period within history. But he says, I'll give you a quote, what I want to argue instead is that it has, it's not a flawed concept, what I want to argue instead is that it has had great truth value for a particular epoch. I want to argue that that epoch is now beginning to draw to a close. I want to suggest that power now instead is largely post-hegemonic. So this is an argument about immediacy. You know, the politics is not played out, does not really happen at this level of discursive or ideological mediation or whatever you want to call that. There is some sort of immediacy, the real, but now the real is not articulated in economic terms as it was by Geras. The real is sort of the new materials real to a certain extent. The real is a biopolitical real. The fact that power relationships are influenced and take place at this level and not at the level of argument or consensus or identification or interpellation and so on and so forth. And the main reference is for Lash. He makes a couple of references to Zizek, but the main references, I think, are, again, Spinoza mainly, although it's a big question whether Spinoza is really saying that, but Spinoza, Hartnegri, Agamben, this sort of Foucauldian biopolitical theory of biopolitics and biopower and so on and so forth. And you have this very interesting, and it's not only Scott Lash, it's a special issue of the journal. So there are many people who try to sort of articulate different dimensions of this argument. There is some work on the economy also, but again, seen from this biopolitical lens, if you want. And the surprising argument, what I find surprising, is this cut, that you have this cut, that hegemony was important within a particular area, then you have this cut, and now hegemony plays no role at all. But this is not bad enough. Things become even more weird when we go to the last contribution I want to mention, which is a whole book by John Beasley Murray. John Beasley Murray comes from a group. This is interesting. There's a group of Latin Americans, especially in the U.S., so mainly people working around doing research on Latin America, Latin American politics, Latin American literature, Alberto Moreiras and people like that, who are, most of them are quite respectful and they are in communication with discourse theory, but some of them, like Beasley Murray, who was a PhD student of Moreiras, they have developed a very aggressive argument and very, you'll see what I mean. Because the book is called Post-Hegemony, and he acknowledges Scott Lash's contribution in the fight against hegemony, presumably. But he wants to put forward an even more radical argument. So he says, I will give you a quote by John Beasley Murray. It's not that hegemony was okay for a particular period and now it's not enough to analyze politics and so on and so forth. He says, there is no hegemony and never has been. We have always lived in post-hegemonic times. Social order was never in fact secured through ideology. Michael. So it's not only hegemony, it's ideology, because it's a sweeping argument. He says, language, representation, mediation, ideology, hegemony, discourse were never really important. No, they didn't really influence anything. This is the argument. It's very interesting. It's a book published by Minnesota University Press. It's really interesting, this argument. And he tries to replace that, because obviously one would ask, okay, and if why are we talking to each other? What, you know, why do we spend so much time doing that if this plays no role at all? But he says he has an alternative conception. He says everything happens through affect, habit, and somehow this is completely isolated from language and representation. It's a really interesting argument. I don't have time to say more things about that. I want to turn to slightly critical, the critical part of the of my talk, if you want. What is wrong with this criticism? I mean, is there anything that is interesting in this criticism? What is happening? How should we deal with these criticisms? Because I think this is important. That's why Ernesto, I think Guerra's argument was not the best argument you could have in academia, but Ernesto Laclau thought it was important to reply to these arguments. And I think it is important to really deal with these arguments when we see them being articulated, and also creating some sort of tradition. There are already at least three contributions on the same topic, which are much more critical than new materialist work. I think the problem with Day is the problem with Day is mostly political, because he's not advancing a theoretical argument. The problem is, okay, let's assume that we don't take into account hegemony, that we want to go to these communities, autonomous communities, and that's fine. The problem emerges when we ask the crucial question, how do these communities collaborate with each other? Because when they are alone, okay, let's say that's fine. But when they need to put forward a demand or a new politics, an alternative political scenario, and so on and so forth, how can they coordinate between each other? Because this is what hegemony, equivalence is all about. And this is interesting because there is an anarchic tradition in Nancy's, but it comes back with Day. He puts forward this concept of affinity. Somehow there is some sort of mystical affinity, but he doesn't really elaborate on how this affinity is produced or how what is the process. Because obviously that would be a process involving language, representation, hegemony, and so forth. So he doesn't want to say that. So this is, I think, that would be the reply, the criticism towards that kind of argument. With Scott Lash, I think there's a problem in this argument, because it involves a certain philosophy of history. You know, there is a period in which this is happening, then there is a cut, there is a new period. And this sounds very suspicious to me. Why is this happening? Why there is no politics in there? It's some sort of predetermined process that happened like that. There's no politics, there's no contingency, nobody can doubt this passage from hegemony to post-hegemony, and so on and so forth. And I think this is a big problem. With Beasley Murray, which is the most radical formulation of this of this argument, there are of course many problems. I will mention two or three of them. First of all the main references he uses, which is Foucault, Norbert Elias, Pierre Bourdieu, none of them has such a radical, I mean all of them. Bourdieu has written a book about language and symbolic power. Elias has written a book about language. None of them, even Foucault, has his own theory of discourse. So none of them has really neglected hegemony, representation, language, discourse so much, and they never engaged in an argument like the one that Beasley Murray is putting forward. So this is one problem. The second problem is the contradictions involved when he's very ambitious, and he wants to hit Ernesto Laclau where he would feel it most. So what is the argument I should advance? Let's go to Argentina. I'm a Latin Americanist. Let's go to Argentina. And he says, I have this example of how politics, and especially not only Argentina in general, Peronism, populism in Argentina. How did Peronism reproduce itself and in politics and manage to interpellate all these masses and so on and so forth? And he says, he gives this argument, this example of talk by, but this is a talk. He gives this example of a speech by Peron, in which Peron addresses 1 million people, I don't know. And he says, it's not a matter of language, it's we communicate, our hearts communicate, and something like that. But this is Peron's speech. This is very interesting. So actually, there's a performative contradiction. He contradicts himself when he's making this argument. And the third, and I'm finishing with that, the third problem is that none of these people have taken into account this move within the last 10, 15 years of the work of Chantal Mouffe for Ernesto Laclau, which is a move towards an understanding of the passions in Chantal, or this move to engage more seriously with Lacanian theory and on populist reason by Laclau and affectivity and enjoyment and so on and so forth. So, at best, these criticisms, and this is interesting, this is an interesting argument, at best these criticisms show that there is also another aspect, which is the affective aspect, the aspect of enjoyment, the aspect of habitus, affect, habit, whatever, and that should be taken into account. But they don't realize that this has been already taken into account by Laclau and Mouffe in the last 10, 15 years. So, nevertheless, I think this is an important issue and has to be addressed further, and I'm sure that many young researchers which are here today will respond to this task. Thank you very much.